I I should tape it to the podium, but it's acrylic. I'm like, eh.
See, I can latch mine on the edge. My problem is I keep twisting. It won't. These new ones have channels in them now.
Grammar.
I have a feeling that both of us can hit the ground before this thing is over with, but. Is the pastor's coming to do interviews? I'm like, what? The pastor's coming to do interviews. I'm like, okay, whatever.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Hi. Test, test. Yep. The other one.
Good morning. All right. Great to have you all here. My name is Al Harrell, and I serve as the CEO of the Southern University System Foundation. I'd like to first take this opportunity to thank Mayor Broome and her staff, as well as the eBay Corporation, for selecting the Vaudrey Center to roll out your program today. The Vaudrey Center is the first of its kind at a historically black college or university, and we're really excited about the programming we have in store here, and we think that what you're discussing here today aligns well with our programming. Mayor Broome started on this journey with us about a year and a half ago, and she was here when this place was just a mound of dirt, and I want to thank her for her support for this program and this venture from the very beginning. Also, I'd like to recognize the eBay Corporation for the very important work that you have endeavored to do, collecting data, right, and making sure that that data is deployed in a meaningful way to help entrepreneurs in our area and throughout the state of Louisiana is very, very important. The Vaudrey Center seeks, in its core mission, to introduce new knowledge, right, cutting-edge research, Ultimately, garnering the charitable impulse for people to give of their resources, their times, their talents, and their treasures. We continue to encourage all of you here as you launch your ventures to do the same. And we can't thank you enough and welcome you to the center and look forward to you coming back. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Al, and thank you so much for the Valdry Center hosting us this morning, and we're glad to be a part of its inaugural initiation, I guess we could say. And we really appreciate Southern University for all the contributions that Southern makes to our community and to the nation, academically, of course, and just being a good community partner. How's everybody doing this morning? Great. Do you like those? You like that breakfast? I didn't get any. So if you want to save me some eggs back there, I would be very grateful for that. I certainly am very excited this morning, and I want to get started first by recognizing our elected officials, many of whom I work with on a regular basis, our council members who are here to support this effort. We have Councilwoman Erica Green, Councilman Dwight Hudson, Councilman Lamont Cole, Councilwoman Barbara Freiberg, and Councilwoman Donna Collins Lewis. Are there any other elected officials that I... Okay, would you celebrate them this morning? And so I believe that this space right here is a perfect space to talk about growing business with technology and to support our local entrepreneurs. I know that the Valdrys are started off as entrepreneurs, and so they grew their business, and now they are certainly some dynamic philanthropists. And so this beautiful building and being able to be here this morning certainly connects with our vision and with our mission. And I'm also very excited to continue to share the great news that eBay's Retail Revival Program is here in the great capital city of Baton Rouge, and they are currently accepting applications. So yesterday we had a very great day. We hosted a group of thought leaders at the old state capitol to talk about entrepreneurship, and today we have brought together businesses, influencers, media, and even some consumers to really dive deeper into this great partnership that we have with eBay. And I don't think I have to give you too many details about eBay, but I'm sure you all are eager to know about the Retail Revival Program to give you more information about that. And so I'm going to start by taking a look back at when it all started in May. Some of you may have been there.
The city of Baton Rouge is partnering with global e-commerce leader eBay to bring their retail revival program to our small businesses.
Our retail revival program involves a very intense course about how to become a digital entrepreneur, a global digital entrepreneur.
How can we bring the power of eBay's brand and platform to a local community so that we can help grow? We will put our muscle behind helping small businesses here in Baton Rouge succeed on a global scale.
We sell sweatshirts. And I think the retail revival can really help grow our business because we're looking to expand places where the climate is a little bit colder.
So opening us up globally as an online presence is huge. Our growth potential, especially this store and the record sales in general, is phenomenal.
It takes some of the stress off of the business owner to have to find all of the ways to list the garments. And they're giving us the help we need to create a great online presence.
eBay is a platform that supports small business. It's really the lifeblood of our company. We chose Baton Rouge because Baton Rouge is just awesome.
Today we're taking yet another step to ensure that Baton Rouge is wide open and ready for business.
They're able to go from thinking about their market of Baton Rouge and transform that sort of in their mind to think about how could their product become a truly global product.
So What is Retail Revival and how can you sign up? I'm glad you asked that question. Retail Revival is a 12-month program that offers participating small businesses a wide and valuable variety of support services and benefits, including comprehensive e-commerce training, one-on-one coaching with a dedicated support team, promotional assets and opportunities, a free eBay store subscription, PR support, and much more. The website that you want to take note of and remember is ebayinc.com/Baton Rouge. That's ebayinc.com/Baton Rouge. And so there are postcards on the tables that you can take with you. This is just the high level details, but our friends from eBay are here today to really answer your questions and tell you more about the great things that this company is doing nationally. This is one of the things that really attracted me to this opportunity most, is that eBay was willing to invest resources in our community that expands access to consumers far beyond our city limits and to countries across the globe. I'm often asked, how much did the city have to pay to get eBay to come here? Zero. Zero. So, and really, to me, this is what public-private partnerships should be all about: sharing strengths, building on common goals, creating win-win situations. I want to introduce a remarkable member of the eBay team right now that I know each of you will get some valuable insight from this morning. I had the opportunity to chat with him this morning briefly, and I will tell you, not only knowing about what he has done and what he does at eBay, but just having a heart-to-heart conversation with him, I have no doubt that he has a message this morning for us. And that is Damien Hooper-Campbell, eBay's first Chief Diversity Officer. You've heard me speak time and time again about creating equitable opportunities in every facet of the work that we do in Baton Rouge. eBay shares that same vision by keeping the power of inclusion, diversity, and opportunity as a central part of their cultural values. Damien has a deep expertise in diversity, inclusion, and his experience spans the technology industry, finance sector, and academia. Previously, he was the first global head of diversity and inclusion at Uber Technologies, and before that, a diversity business partner and community strategist for Google. Please join me in welcoming Damien Hooper-Campbell.
All right. Well, first and foremost, I want to thank Mayor President Broome for having me. I want to thank this beautiful city and this parish for having all of eBay. I got in late, y'all, like 1 a.m., all right? So I'm on a few hours of sleep. So if you see me fumbling a little bit, know that it's not because I'm disinterested. It's just because I'm usually getting about 7 hours of sleep, and I got about 3. But let me tell you something. I wouldn't miss this for the world. And so thank you very much for partnering with eBay, for welcoming us into your family and into your home. I also just want to thank my colleagues here, Denzel and Ashley, from our government relations team who have made this possible today. So thank you all. So look, I was noodling on what would y'all actually want to hear from me today. Do you want to hear all about Retail Revival? And I was kind of told, look, there are pamphlets on the tables. You all have heard about it a lot, and you know where to go to apply. And as I learn more and more about this city and this parish, it's very clear to me that this is an interesting intersection and time for you all. You all have been through some things, and the only way to move forward is to actually put those things out on the table. And so what's interesting about that reality is my work, which I'm going to tell you about in just a moment, is all about that. It's all about getting beyond the corporate BS. It's all about us actually becoming more human again and actually having the conversations about the things that sometimes are painful, but the things that we know we have to actually engage in if we're going to move forward.
which is a bit of a different thing for diversity and inclusion. So what I want to do with the limited amount of time that I have today are three things. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about me. Thank you, Mayor President, for giving a little bit of my background. I want to tell you about why 6 years ago, if you told me I was going to be a chief diversity officer, I would have looked at you sideways, right? And I'll tell you a little bit about my journey to today. The second thing I want to do is I want to hear from you all. Oftentimes, people in my position stand in front of you and talk at you for 15 minutes. I think it'd be silly for me to have all these brilliant minds in the room and not to actually hear from you. So I'm going to do that. And then we'll just wrap up, and I'll tell you a few things about the ways that we are approaching diversity and inclusion at eBay, not just in the US, but globally. Does that work for y'all? Okay, cool. So one thing I typically do when I'm in front of an audience is I try to make sure that in a very short amount of time, we can get beyond the surface level stuff. So what we typically do in these sessions and these engagements is I say, hey, how you doing? You say, oh, I'm great. And we show up with our representatives. By a show of hands, how many of you have ever seen the movie Meet the Parents or Meet the Fockers with Robert De Niro, Ben Stiller? Okay. For anybody who hasn't, in the spirit of inclusion, there's this infamous scene, right? There's this infamous scene in the movie where, so Robert De Niro is the father of this young woman, and he's a former CIA agent, so he's super skeptical about everything and super cynical about everything, and nobody's good enough for his daughter. And so Ben Stiller is his daughter's, you know, significant other, and he comes home to meet the parents, Robert De Niro and his wife, and Robert De Niro's all over him. And there's this infamous scene where Robert De Niro catches Ben in the hallway of his home. Robert De Niro's in his robe, it's his crib. And Ben stops, and Robert De Niro's like, hey, you, come over here. And he says, I see you trying to warm up to me and my family. I get it. And then he draws something on this piece of paper. Anybody remember what it was called? Circle of Trust. He draws this circle of trust on the piece of paper, and he says, Ben, me and my family, we're inside the circle of trust. And then at the top right of that piece of paper, he draws a little dot and he says, this is you, my brother. You're way out here trying to get in, right? So why do I tell you that? I tell you that, one, because I think it's a pretty funny movie. For those who didn't raise their hands, you should check it out. But I also say it because I don't want you to have your representative here today. Whether in a moment when we have a quick conversation right here, or the conversations we're gonna have afterwards, or the subsequent conversations that you're gonna have with eBay about entrepreneurship, about diversity and inclusion, please don't show up with your representative. Show up as your real self, okay? So I just need a thumbs up for those who are able to say we're okay being inside the circle of trust, at least for the next 20 minutes or so. Thumbs up? Good? Okay, perfect. All right, so let me tell you a little bit about myself. So this is my first time in Baton Rouge. I was born in Harlem, New York. Anybody ever been to Harlem by show of hands? Okay, uptown in the building, love it. So I was born in Harlem, New York, single parent. My mother, Diane Winston, apple of my eye, that's my queen. My parents got divorced when I was about 10 months old. My dad is from Guyana, South America. So he's Caribbean, you know, came to the United States in his late 20s, met my mom. They had me about 10 months old. They decided it wasn't that great for them to be together. So it was just my mother and I. We moved from Harlem to Jersey. So I lived in Jersey for a bit. Then my mother had this crazy idea to go and get her MBA in Chicago for a couple of years and to quit her job. So we lived on the South Side. And then we moved to Connecticut because we said, look, we can't afford great public school or private schools. So we're going to go to a town that has a really good public school. I tell you that because in each one of those communities, there were journeys of identity. When I was in Harlem, I was too young to really remember anything. But when I went to Jersey, I was in a very multicultural environment. I went to school with people who were from Colombia and Mexico and Germany and people who were from Georgia and different places across the United States. When I went to the South Side of Chicago, it was a room that looked mostly like this, black and Latino and Hispanic. And then when I went to Connecticut, I was one of eight black folks out of 800 people in my high school. And so that was also a very interesting experience of belonging and being who I am. And then I graduated high school and said, look, I want a different academic experience, and so I went to Morehouse College. Any Morehouse alums in the building? No, I'm solo? Okay, cool. I know where I am, by the way. I know where I am. I know what turf I'm on. Let me be very clear about that. But Doug Williams was, you know, president at some point. He was head of our football team at some point. But I know I'm in HBCU territory, so I'm happy to be here. And so I went to Morehouse. I graduated. I went to Wall Street. And then after Wall Street, I went and did economic development back in Harlem and worked for a nonprofit trying to help other nonprofits to become more self-sustainable. And so all throughout that time, I was defining my own journey. I was understanding from other people what inclusion meant to them, what exclusion meant to them, what it meant to actually invest in communities, what it meant to actually be diverse and inclusive within other people's minds. And so it was a great journey for me, but when I got this call from Google after going to business school and working on Wall Street, Google called me and they said, look, we need some help with this thing called diversity and inclusion. I said, no, I don't believe this. Most companies don't necessarily want to actually invest in this. They just want to check the box and say, hey, we're done, we hired somebody, now let's move on. But the more that I listened, my grandmother was like, baby, Google called you? You need to go on and listen to that. And so the more I listened, the more I realized that the tech industry had what I think is the perfect set of parameters to actually move the needle on diversity and inclusion. Number one, we're based on innovation. We don't thrive in the technology industry without innovation. All of us use gadgets that pretty much every 6 months they come out with a new version. It's all about innovation. Number two, you have to have capital to actually invest in this. And the technology industry has that. And number three, if you've ever been to Silicon Valley, inside of some of these corporate walls, you need a real visible problem. And we have a visible problem in that we don't have the diversity and inclusion that we need to continue to thrive every single day. And so I made the leap 5 years ago. I went to Google, loved it, and then I went to Uber to become their first global head of diversity and inclusion. And about 4 years ago, our CEO, who you saw in that video, Devin Wenig, created this role at eBay and said, hey, please come here and help us to build this from scratch. And so I've been blessed to be in this role for the past 3 years, and it's been a phenomenal journey. And so I do this work because I care. I do this work because I believe those to whom much has been given, much is expected. And I do this work because this, for me and for eBay, yes, it's about the right thing to do. Yes, it's personal. But it's also about closing this gap of income inequality that you see between many minority communities and majority communities. And it's part of why retail revival is so important, because we need to see more small businesses accessing the 180 million buyers that we have across the globe to actually drive revenue and to be more sustainable, okay? So that's a little bit about me. I will tell you my favorite shows right now are Billions, Love and Hip Hop Atlanta, don't judge me, okay? and I'll leave it at that. But a lot of people say, what is diversity and inclusion? And when I first joined eBay, I spent my first week literally in our Dublin, Ireland office and in our Berlin, Germany office. And when I showed up, they said, well, what is diversity and inclusion? And I said, I don't know, you tell me. Because that's the first problem, is too often people in my role join a company, come to a city, come to a parish, and we tell you what diversity and inclusion is. That's actually the antithesis of the way it's supposed to go. And so this is now that second part of today where we're really gonna test this circle of trust. I wanna know from y'all who are here as influencers, as students, as public servants, as entrepreneurs, what does diversity and inclusion actually mean here in Baton Rouge? And what I'm not looking for is the textbook answer, the dictionary answer, the safe answer. I wanna know, based on how you grew up, at your dinner tables, with your family, your experiences, the good, the bad, the ugly, when I say the word diversity, let's just tackle them separately. Diversity first. What does that actually mean to you? So I'm looking for a few folks who are okay to be inside the circle of trust and to be brave and to give an honest answer about what diversity means to them. And I'd like for you to be quick. Any volunteers? Yeah, sure, in the back. A mixture. Mixture of what? Okay. And what's your name? Okay, I'm gonna try that again. Sherilyn Hayward with Leroy's Lip Smackin' Lemonade. Okay, can we give her a round of applause for going first? Okay. What else? Who else? What's diversity? Yes, ma'am. Ooh, I like that. Can I use that? Okay, I like that. Something like scrambled eggs. I didn't really have breakfast this morning either, so you're making me hungry. Okay, what else? Yes. Who's everybody? Okay. 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 Did everybody hear that? Okay. All right. Thank you. Anybody else? What's diversity? Yes. Different thoughts. Okay. Go ahead. Yeah, you got it.
I mean, so not just the color of our skin, but the way we think.
Okay.
So that process, the diverseness in that, I think is part of diversity.
Okay, great. Thank you. Right behind me? Thank you.
So I'm just going to piggyback on what she said. If it's thought processes and perspectives, that all comes from experiences. So in diversity in business, you are presenting in your business what you have been exposed to. Mm-hmm. So if you go to a large company, you're going to bring that diversity or that exposure and perspective to that company that obviously someone there that's already present has not been able to encounter.
Right.
So when you come to the table, you're bringing your experiences and perspective.
Love it. Love it. Thank you. Any last ones? Okay.
So since we're in Louisiana, I think of it as a gumbo. Some people like dark meat in their gumbo, white meat, hot sausage, mild sausage, crab, shrimp. They like it spicy or mild. So everything flavors the gumbo. Everything you add to it flavors it and makes it a whole lot better.
Okay, thank you. Gumbo and scrambled eggs. All right. All right. Denzel, I don't know where we're going to lunch, but let's do it. All right. And I'm going to take these last two really quickly, and then we're going to move on.
Whenever I think about diversity, I think about colors, you know, just like the thing on the screen. You know, I just think about a conglomerate group of colors.
Okay, thank you.
I would look at it as a difference in representation. Differences in representation.
Representation of what? Of like people who tie their shoes one way or the other, like what?
In representation of the whole. If it whole in the business world, whole in life, whole in community, whole in nationality, just whole, a difference in a way of being represented of the whole.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. So first of all, nice job in Circle of Trust and starting out. All of that is correct. The best definition I've ever heard, which is not mine, was or is that diversity is variances in people, right? Simply put, variances across people. So that's the first part. What's the other word? Inclusion, right? So diversity, we kind of got that. We get bombarded with that word on a regular basis. What about the inclusion thing? What does it actually mean when we say inclusion? So we got variances in people, but what does inclusion mean? Here, to you, yes.
Intentionally opening opportunities to businesses, individuals who are all at different levels. So it could be gender, sexual orientation, it could be background, it could be size of company. And I think when I look at inclusion, intentionally including them is not only advertising bids to everybody, but it's making sure that projects are at a level that everybody can participate. Thank
you. Who else? Yes.
I see inclusion as simply nothing about me without me. That it doesn't matter whether we're making a government decision, a governance decision, a business decision. Have you looked analytically at the representation of who this decision is going to impact? And have you brought those individuals to the table and have nothing about me without me?
Can I borrow that one too? I feel like people want to snap or clap for that one. I heard a lot of, y'all getting deep. It's kind of early for me. Can I get another coffee? All right, go ahead.
I'm borrowing this, but it's not only being invited to the table, but being allowed to eat.
Yeah, I'm dropping jewels this morning. I'm loving this. Yes, I'm coming right back to you, brother.
I think it's intentionally understanding barriers that people have in getting to certain places or being included in certain things and knocking those barriers down.
I'm going to come back over to you, ma'am.
I think inclusion has a lot to do with businesses and organizations having the courage to provide and to give opportunities to non-traditional partners and those partners that they may not have done business with in the past, but have been underrepresented.
Respect. Okay, great. I'll come right up there. We're going to go there, and I'll come up there, and then we're gonna move on.
Okay, inclusion. I think about bringing all people together, regardless of business, church, recreational events, whatever the thing is, you're bringing everybody together such that all lives matter. Black lives matter, red lives matter, green, yellow, brown, whatever. They're all respected and they're all able to join in with decision making or whatever the event may be.
I love it. I need you to just come with me on a regular basis and just, yes, thank you. I'm loving what you're saying. And then I saw a hand over here. Yes.
I think inclusion to me is one simple word, is access. And access, having the ability, someone mentioned about being at the table, and so many times here in Baton Rouge, we're very comfortable with just being with our own, in our own silos, and we don't have the opportunity to understand the opportunities to leverage across the table. But to me, it's about access. Access to opportunities and leverage.
Love it. Wow, this is great. Yes, oh, you got one, yes.
Okay, so don't throw rocks at me. Because we're in Baton Rouge and we're talking about Baton Rouge, it looks like more than 2% of city parish contracts going to other than minority, 2% in the city of Baton Rouge. That's what it's looked like over the years. Just put in place a disparity study to tell us what we already know, that it's not inclusion, it's not equity, it's not equality. It's about being honest and having those conversations that are uncomfortable to have. And we're in the room and we're talking about all these things, and all of those things are important. But when you drill down to it, when we look at contracts led by this city parish, less than 2% go to minorities.
We said circle of trust. Thank you. Okay, fantastic. You all have told me what diversity and inclusion means to you all here locally, and I love it. How many of you have ever had a guest at your home who is not a family member? Somebody who spends the night, spends a couple of days at your home, raise your hands high, who's not a family member. Okay, I'm just looking for one word adjectives. If you like this person, I know sometimes in-laws are challenging, but if you like this person, how do you want them to feel? One word adjective. Comfortable, loved, welcome. I'm sorry? I heard welcomed. Anything else? Accepted. Any other words? Valued, safe, respected, included, embraced, comfortable, right? Like, ultimately, when we think about inclusion, that's what we're talking about. And alongside all of those adjectives are words and realities like access. And I want to talk a little bit about, I believe, someone who was here said about intentionality and being intentional about this stuff. A lot of times you will hear this theory of, oh, well, if you have a bunch of diverse people and it's a good environment, things will just happen. No. That's not good enough. There's a woman named Verna Myers who actually came up with this saying that you may or may not have heard, but for people who really still don't get diversity and inclusion, I say it like this. Diversity, and it's very close to what you were saying, diversity can be likened to, let's say all of us get a ping on our phone right now, and it's an invitation for a party on Saturday. And we all get it, because there's lots of diversity in this room beyond what we can all see. And we all get the invitation. Nobody's left out. The folks running the camera, the folks who are serving us this amazing food, everybody in this room actually gets an invitation. So fast forward to Saturday, and everybody's there, and we're looking good. That's diversity. You have diversity there at the party. But then you look a little bit down towards the dance floor, and it's only certain people who are at that party who are being invited to actually dance at that party. And so the saying goes that if diversity is everybody being invited to the party, inclusion is everybody being invited to dance when they're at that party. And that's what we're trying to get towards. See, diversity is relatively easy. We can go, you know, at eBay, and we can go out to Morehouse and to Southern and to women's colleges and Hispanic serving institutions, and we can recruit all day long. And we can get people excited about coming, right? And they can get there to that campus and still not feel all of those adjectives that you all just described: welcome, safe, embraced, accepted, loved. And if people, regardless of what unique ideas you bring to the table, don't feel that way when they're working at your small businesses, you will not get the best out of them. And then you will not get those blockbuster ideas that will help you to remain competitive. And so at eBay, we think about this globally across three buckets. Number one is the workforce. That means not only who you hire. So are we being, back to that word, intentional about going to women's colleges? Are we being intentional about making sure that we get to Baton Rouge and get people to actually apply to Retail Revival? Are we being intentional when I'm in the Korea office about making sure that we are proactively going out and trying to find people with disabilities, or proactively going out and trying to find people from a younger generation? Or when we are in Istanbul and thinking about people from different religions, are we being intentional about actually telling those communities that they have a place at eBay? And then it's also about, what's the process? Because you can get somebody to apply, but if the process that you go through during your interview is biased, or if you don't see anybody who looks like you during your interview, some of us maybe don't care about that, but a lot of us do, especially when we're one of the only. We care about seeing people who look like us, right? So it's not just who we hire, but it's also the processes. And that's part of what I influence as Chief Diversity Officer at eBay. In fact, I own the university recruiting team to make sure that when we are building our strategy, it's an inherent part of what we do. So that's workforce. Anybody remember the second one? Workplace, okay? So what's the point in hiring great people for your small business, for the business that you're starting up, if when they get to work, it sucks to work there? I have a learning disability, ADHD. For a long time, I didn't tell companies that I had that disability because I was sure that they would use that against me. eBay and some of the tech companies I've worked for is really the first time I felt comfortable talking about that. Imagine if I had to come to work every single day and hide that. So while other people who may not have those same struggles are coming to work and just coming out with great ideas, I'm working overtime to try to hide that. Or somebody who might not be openly gay, coming to work and trying to hide their sexual orientation. Or somebody who may be thinking in a different way but might be too junior in the organization and feel like their voice is not heard, that they're not welcome, they're not loved, they're not accepted or safe, has to deal with that. Or being the only woman, being the only Black woman on your team,
not only being a woman, but also being a woman of color. And having to think about that when you get to the meeting table instead of just thinking about the ideas that you want to put out there on the table. And so the second part around workplace is about how do we make the people who are employees at eBay feel included every single day? And there are things that we do around policies to make sure that people get paid equally. There are things that we do around creating community as well. I just recently had members of the Black community over to my house to create community, because sometimes folks just want to have a community where they can have a real open conversation. And so the point is, can we do that at my house, but can we also do it inside of eBay? And so we've built a series called Courageous Conversations where we're running towards creating safe spaces inside of the company where people can talk about politics, where we can talk about the fact that half of the country votes one way and the other half votes another way. When the elections happen back in 2016, people across the country and across the world came into work either feeling elated and excited or feeling really down. And so we can no longer, in this day and age, act like the things that affect us outside of work can't be talked about inside of work. I grew up with people saying, don't talk about religion, don't talk about politics. That's gone. Can't do that anymore. And so it's on me and my team and my CEO to make sure that we're creating spaces inside of the company for people to actually run towards those conversations. So that's the workplace. And then the third bucket that we think about is our marketplace. And that's all about you all. It's all about you all. Like, how in the world are we going to survive as a company if we only think about the buyers and sellers we currently have? The whole purpose of our business is to create economic opportunity for all people using our platform. But if we're not thinking about the folks who might be small businesses, minority-owned businesses in Baton Rouge, and we're not being intentional in asking you to apply to Retail Revival, then shame on us. If we're not thinking about the Muslim woman who is based in the UK and thinking about, well, do we have listings on our platform that are actually relevant to her? Do we have listings on our platform that are relevant to people who might be plus size and can't find clothes usually? Do we have listings on our platform for hair care for different cultures? That doesn't just happen by accident. And when we're more intentional about it every single day, you know what that does? That makes sellers feel more included, it makes buyers feel more included, and it drives business for our company. And so this isn't just a feel-good kind of role. It definitely feels good, but it's also about being intentional and driving business at our company. And so we do things like this. This pin that I have on today is the Black Panther pin. And no, you can't have it, all right? I'm just saying, somebody gonna ask me. You were gonna ask, okay, all right. I wanna get it out the way now. If I had more, I would definitely give them. But this is a prime example. So we did a partnership with a group called Blavity, which is a Black-owned startup for young Black millennials who decided that they were gonna own content for the Black community. And they started a company called Blavity, and we were their first corporate sponsor for a big conference they have called Afrotech that brings together entrepreneurs, investors, artists, et cetera. And it's grown like crazy over the past few years. But last year, someone on my team said, hey, Black Panther, super relevant, seller, super relevant. And so we partnered with a sister named Dorian Fletcher, who is the sister who designed all of the jewelry for the Black Panther movie, and onboarded her onto our platform as a seller, and brought her and the brother named Sanford Green, who actually designed the comic book for Black Panther, to Afrotech, to eBay's booth, and had Dorian's jewelry and Sanford's comic books there for sale, where people could actually walk up and use the eBay app. And so I had to get one. But my point to you in that conversation is simply, that is us trying to be intentional. Are we perfect at it? Absolutely not. Do we have a long way to go? Absolutely. But do we feel like this conversation with you all today, and hopefully all of you in this room who feel compelled, applying to join the Retail Revival program here in Baton Rouge, is a step in the right direction? Absolutely. So I've taken a lot of your time. I want to say thank you. I don't know if we have time for any Q&A. I'm going to leave that to the organizers. I will tell you straight up, Circle of Trust, I will answer the questions that I actually know the answers to. If I don't know the answers, I won't BS you. And if I can't tell you the answer, I'm going to tell you that I can't tell you the answer. All right? But anyway, thank you very much for having us today. Open it up to any questions you may have.
One of the challenges when it comes to entrepreneurship are those persons who have less than stellar backgrounds. And of course, getting a small business loan is already tedious and difficult to do anyway. How do we get funding for people who have a less than clean background so that they can open up their business or expand their business?
Yeah, well, look, I think the beauty of eBay is that unlike maybe starting a brick and mortar, which we love, by the way. We love brick and mortar businesses. They are the foundation of small businesses in this country. But we have people who literally look around their homes, see a gift that maybe was given to them that's brand new, that they don't want anymore, and that's how they got started. I literally was in Las Vegas. We have a big seller event that I want all of you small businesses to think about coming to next year called eBay Open, because we need to see more of this community at that event. So it's called eBay Open, 2 or 3 days that we spend talking about new product releases. We spend helping sellers to understand how to be more effective as sellers. And I did a panel with some sellers. And this one guy started selling when he was 16 years old. He said he wasn't old enough to open an eBay account, so he had to get his mother's social security number. And she opened the account for him, young Hispanic brother. And he started selling sneakers. He now, that's his full-time job. And he started that just with the things that he had. And so I think I understand if you are trying to sell something of larger inventory and you want to purchase, you know, larger inventory, how can you get a loan to do that? What I would say to all of you is that the beauty of the platform is, you know, you don't have to necessarily have a brick and mortar business. You can look at what's around you. You can look at what's out there. And you can buy those things and sell those things on our platform, and you're going to a global audience of 180 million people. Now, we don't offer loans per se. I know that there are, and I'd leave that to folks in the room who focus on economic development locally, but I know that there are oftentimes in cities programs for folks to try to help folks to get that kind of capital and get access to capital. And so I'm not sure exactly what's available here. I would imagine that there are some things that are available. What I would encourage you to think about, though, is what is immediately around you. In the retail revival program, you know, typically it costs to open up a storefront on eBay, a virtual storefront. This retail revival program offers that to you for free as part of our partnership with Baton Rouge. And so, I would encourage you to think about the things that are around you. But from a brick and mortar, you know, getting an operational loan standpoint, I imagine that there are programs that are out here for that. So that's the best answer that I have for you. I know that it may not satisfy the appetite for what you were asking, but that's the beauty of eBay is you don't necessarily need a huge operational loan in order to get started.
Okay. And a lot of our sellers, whether they're in the program or not, you know, a lot of our sellers have started, you know, at their homes because they couldn't get this brick and mortar type loan. And again, as Damien said, that's the beauty of eBay. I mean, we have folks who have started in their home and now they have not only a brick and mortar, but a warehouse where they're keeping things just from kind of starting on the platform, because the beauty of it is the fact that you're opening up your marketplace to 180 million people. One of the things that, you know, Damien, myself, and Vineeth were talking about on the way here is how eBay does that. So I think of a story of a seller who was in our first retail revival program in Akron. Brian Robinson sells guitars. And so, you know, if you think about that, Akron, Ohio, you don't really think about guitars. So he not only had, you know, standard guitars, but he had guitars that were, you know, upwards of $5,000, $7,000. And so he wasn't really selling those kind of guitars. As soon as he got into the program, started working with our one-on-one concierge services, started working with our marketing plans, doing the trainings. He started, you know, switching around how he was really marketing his stuff. He's now selling guitars to over 20 different countries. He's selling to almost every state in the United States, and he's just expanded his marketplace. So when people ask, you know, why are we here? What's the benefit of doing this? I mean, I always say marketplace. I mean, you're opening up your marketplace to 180 million buyers.
Before the next question, when I heard you talk about the eBay open experience, I had a little sidebar with Denzel, but I am willing to personally sponsor three people your airline tickets to go to eBay open, okay? So I guess we'll have to figure out a way to do that. You might want to put your name in a hat and we'll pull it. Put your name in the hat and we'll get three people and I'll pay for your airline ticket.
That's beautiful. That's intentionality. Thank you. Yes.
So Councilwoman Collins Lewis kind of leaned into it with the inequities that exist in Baton Rouge. And I think that Mayor Broome is attempting to be intentional about inclusion and equity. But I would like to ask you, as someone who's gone around the country and the globe, two parts. What are the ingredients you find in the communities that are successful at equity and inclusion? Because we're not. And two, what would you say is the greatest hindrance that you've seen in communities to accomplishing equity and inclusion? And because we have Metro Council members, I'll give you more context. We have 7 white Republicans and 5 black Democrats, and a city that is 48% black in the parish, 48% white in the parish, 58% in the city. And so the representation of diversity is all over this community. But when we look at the income gaps and all of those things, we lack true equity and inclusion.
I love that question. Thank you for asking it. So let me take the first part. What are the ingredients that I've seen in places that are successful? And by the way, success is subjective, right? I would actually say, and this is me as an outsider, so no disrespect, I would actually say I think you all are successful. I look at this leader you have, who you acknowledged. I look at the fact that it seems like you're starting or continuing to have some deeper conversations. I look at the fact that, you know, as I talk to Vineet this morning and hear about some of the trauma that the city has gone through just in the past couple of years with floods and shootings, et cetera, y'all are still standing. You're not backing down. Y'all are here leaning forward. I actually see part of success as the journey, not necessarily always the destination. It's the fact that you're fighting and that you're trying to lean forward. So that, let me just be clear on that, because I don't know that I know of cities offhand where I'd say they have everything perfect. I think that there are some cities that do certain things really well, but I don't know that I know of a city that does everything perfectly that has reached this, you know, ideal state of success. So let me just start with that context. But in answering the first part of your question, the ingredients, honesty. Okay? Honesty. Like, there's absolutely no way to move forward when you have had trauma if you're unwilling to deal with that trauma. Okay? I have a therapist. The only way that I make sure, I'm gonna get real personal because we said we're family, right? The only way that I make sure that when my wife and I are blessed, hopefully, to have children, that I don't pass on some of the negative things from my background is to address them with someone who knows what they're doing. Not my barber, not always my pastor. I love my pastor, by the way, in case he sees this. but with a professional who actually knows how to address those situations. And so the cities where I see cops being brought together with members of the community, where typically they'd be on opposite sides, and they have someone who is a professional in the middle facilitating that conversation, that's successful. Someone said earlier, I think it was you, and I don't remember the exact phrase, but oftentimes you see cities go through a revitalization period or economic development. And the people who are involved in that conversation around what that's gonna look like are not necessarily the people who are of that city. Or you have to have a certain degree or a certain pedigree to be a part of that conversation. No.
I want to talk to whoever. And I don't just want to talk, I want to talk to majority and minority. That's another challenge. When we talk about this diversity and inclusion thing, a lot of companies, and I'm going to bring it back to a company because it's relevant to a city, a lot of companies, in the best effort to make the Black community feel included, to make the Hispanic and Latino community feel included, to make the women's community or the LGBT plus community feel included, we race towards that, but then it ends up being inclusion just for those small groups. I can't be a person of color inside of a company or inside of a community talking about challenges that are partially on me and my community and partially on a majority community and not involve the majority community in that conversation. Otherwise, it's just a bunch of us over in a corner lamenting about the problems. And when you do involve that majority community, and this is real hard, this is real, real, real hard for folks who have been oppressed historically, showing empathy to a group of folks who are outside of your community who maybe have been seen as the oppressors, that's hard. That's real hard. You don't want to give deference to that community because you're so tired of being oppressed. And I have to come in and say sometimes to historically disadvantaged and oppressed communities, we're not going to get anywhere unless you invite folks in and you give them a chance to also heal and to make mistakes in the conversation and to say things that might be off-putting, but you, instead of pouncing on them, you say, look, I don't know what your intent was, but here's how that landed on me, and make it a learning moment. And so cities that I think do really well, they call people into the conversation versus calling them out. Because calling people out, all it's gonna do is continue the divisive nature of what is going on in this country and what's going on in this world. But that's really hard, okay? The other thing that I see people doing is they acknowledge that it's over time, not overnight. Y'all have a long history here. In the United States, minorities have a long history of oppression. Just like I grew up at a dinner table with my grandparents from North Carolina, hearing certain things, just like I grew up with a strong Black mother who was on Wall Street who used to say to me, you know, I'm raising a Black man in the United States. You gotta show up earlier and leave later. There are things that we inherit from our elders, just like there are things that other folks inherit from their elders. When you are programmed in a certain way from birth, or you see certain things on television, or you have an experience with the police or with someone else, that is trauma. It takes more than just a policy or a conversation for an hour to change that. That's long term, brother. And I had to realize in this role that just like the Rosa Parks and Marcus Garveys and Malcolms and Martins came before me and they didn't solve everything, I might not solve everything. And so my point is that I think cities that are successful also manage expectations and put into context that even when you're having honest conversations, even when you're showing empathy at a different level than maybe we have historically showed empathy to each other, even when you're bringing my majority and minority together and it's us with them instead of us versus them, it still takes time, which doesn't mean we get to be complacent. We still need to have a sense of urgency and accountability, but it takes time. And if you think the tech industry is one where, you know, we create apps overnight in 24 hours and these things called hackathons, and then we roll out these products, and the whole mindset is launch the product and then iterate on it. If there's a bug with it, you'll get an update, right? In your app, it'll say, time to update, we're fixing these bugs. That's really hard to do with human beings, right? It's not the same thing. And so that's what I think people get right in those situations. In terms of the biggest hindrance is, in my opinion, is overemphasis on just data. So a lot of times we talk about diversity and inclusion, and in the news you'll see, oh, such and such company increased this community representation by X percent, or they went down, or they stayed flat. And people from the outside who have never really been in the trenches doing this work are like, oh, that sucks, this company doesn't care about diversity. Farthest thing from the truth. Data is very important, but sometimes we rely on data and just quantitative things solely, and we forget the human part of it. What I mean by that is some of the best moments I've had in terms of breaking through is when I make it personal for somebody. A lot of times we think about diversity and inclusion, we just think black, white, gay, straight, Muslim, Christian. Okay, maybe those are some of the things that are a part of it, definitely, most certainly. But sometimes if we had more time, instead of asking you all, what does inclusion mean, I would have said to you, tell me about one time in your life when you've ever felt excluded for any reason. And let me tell you, I've done that conversation with a room of 300 people who are not racial or ethnic minorities. And when you hear what people come back with, I was the first person in my class to come from outside of the United States, and I was the only one who wasn't allowed to hold the flag during the Pledge of Allegiance. When you hear people talking about being of a certain size as a kid and not getting picked for the kickball team, sure, those things seem, you know, small compared to maybe some of the things that we go through in our community. But what it does is it brings people into a place where I can say, okay, you know how sucky that felt to be that kid who didn't get picked. Guess what? There are people right now trying to get inside of this company, trying to get access to capital and small business loans, who are feeling the same way that you feel. And then all of a sudden a light bulb goes off and it's like, oh, so this isn't some policy that's forcing me to do this. This is a very human experience, and where I thought maybe I didn't have anything in common with the person sitting across from me, actually I do. That's what you mean by inclusion? Oh, I know how that feels, that sucks. And so I think the biggest hindrance right now, and you see it, we just had, you know, a very tragic incident, 30 minutes from my house, a mass shooting at the Gilroy Garlic Festival, right? 3 people lost their lives, 4 people lost their lives, including the shooter. It's 30 minutes from my crib. My wife and I were thinking about going to it the day before. We've become overly focused on data. We've become so focused on rhetoric that, like, we are just forgetting to be human. And so I think that is the biggest hindrance. I don't have some other magical thing. It's about being human. I sat on the plane on the way over here, and I'll keep it real. The guy I sat across from, when he first came, I was like, oh man, this is gonna be a tough one, right? He didn't look like me. I made some, even as chief diversity officer, we all have biases. I made some judgments about this dude. Man, by the end of that flight, that dude was helping me with my bag down. When the plane was taking off and my little bottle of water was about to fall, he caught it for me. But like, I just forgot to be human and to give this dude a chance. And instead I let everything about what I associate with the person who looks like him, in my experience, which is all valid, block me from having that. So it's a long answer, but I don't want to give you some corporate nonsense. That's what it is. It's about being human, man. And so we have to find ways to do that, but that takes time. All right?
Wow. You're a preacher for sure. I had a lot of things that I wanted to just ask one particular question, but your comments just now were so profound. And I want to just tell you thank you for, even though you say this is your first time being in Baton Rouge, when you were speaking, I felt as if you were from the city. Literally, because you read every aspect of our community in such a way, like, you felt it and you understood where we have been and where we're trying to go and what we've tried to accomplish. And you don't know this, and I know everybody in this room kind of picked up on some of the little stuff that you said, and it was like, oh my God, he's absolutely right. That's us, that's us, that's us. And not only that, but you gave us solutions. And I so appreciate that. Thank you so very much. We're gonna definitely get you some gumbo. But I do have a question, specifically more of a practical question about businesses. I am wanting to actively make sure that businesses in my area, I represent a part of Baton Rouge, Southern University. LSU downtown is all in District 10, and so I have a very kind of the gumbo of Baton Rouge. Everything is in District 10, and so I have businesses, small businesses, that in some aspects in District 10 are thriving and doing okay. A couple of the businesses that were on the video were in my district, but at the same time, I still have a myriad of companies, small companies that are fledgling, that are trying to get there to that point. So my question is when eBay comes in, technology is a component of that. What specific, because I want to be very direct and methodical about those companies that apply and making sure that they have that opportunity. What kind of company should I be looking for as a councilwoman to say, you need to make sure that you apply, these are the resources that are available, and does technology help, are you guys actively involved in that technology piece for companies that need that really at the core of what they're trying to do to accomplish, to move forward?
I will say something really quickly, and then I'm going to pass it to Denzel, because he is the regular, the resident expert. You know, when you think about listings on our platform, we don't sell firearms, right, on our platform. There are certain things we don't sell, like a lot of perishable goods. You know, there are places across the world where we have partnerships where maybe we do kind of grocery-related stuff, but that's very small, so we don't sell those kinds of perishable goods on our platform. We do really well when it comes to fashion and apparel. We do really well when it comes to equipment, right, for businesses or restaurants. We do really well when it comes to electronics, right, home and garden goods. Like, we have more listings on our platform than any other e-commerce site in the world, right? Over 1 billion listings on our platform. So there's a broad diversity of things that are on our platform. And we also, there's a myth. Let me just actually ask a question, then I'm gonna pass it on to Denzel. Just throw out some numbers. What percentage of the things on eBay, so 1.1, 1.2 billion listings, right, globally, do you think are used? How much? 50 to 60%? 90% used? Lower, okay. All right, so the reality is that on our platform, about 85, 90% of the stuff is brand new. And the challenge for us is that when we started the e-commerce game 25 years ago, Piero Midiar, immigrant, started it in his garage. And we sold, the first thing we sold was a broken laser pointer for like $14.83. And so when we started it, it was very much about, look in your garage, it's an auction. That's the other question. How much of our stuff do you think you have to like bid on versus you can just buy it at a fixed price? How much do you think you have to bid on? 5%, only 5%? Okay, so 95% you could buy immediately. Okay, we're gonna stop right there. So that's close enough, right? So fixed price, meaning you can buy it right away, about 90%, 85, 90%, right? Only, you know, 10, 15% is auction. Now people always think of eBay as a garage sale with a bunch of used stuff, and auction where you gotta wait and people gotta bid. Nah, right? We've changed over time. And we still love the used stuff. We have lots of antiques and collectibles, sports memorabilia. I mean, I sat with somebody in Las Vegas who's doing like over $1 million a year in sports memorabilia alone, right? So lots of different things, but there's some myths that are out there. So whether you have used items, right? Or whether you have brand new items, they're all welcome there. Dee, anything you wanna add?
Yeah, only thing I would add is that I think to Damien's point, because our platform is so diverse, people may want to kind of say, oh, well, I don't know if I could sell on the platform because, you know, I sell hair care products, or I sell, you know, this is a herbal thing that I just created and I don't know if it makes sense to sell on the platform, apply. That's why we have the application process. The application process isn't really for us to kind of block people from being a part of it. It's really for us to kind of say, okay, you have this item. We think it'd do well on the site because of this, this, and this. This is why we want you, and this is why we want to help grow you. So the businesses that you have, and you know, back to the point of, even if it's not a brick and mortar type business, even if, you know, you have recently got off the ground, you have your product ready, you may not have your labeling ready, but you just really have something that you're selling either in the community or elsewhere. I met a student yesterday who was telling me about her product and how she has a tea and how, you know, she's just trying to, there she is. You know, she's trying to figure out her website. She's trying to figure out, you know, how to market. And she's already selling, but just needs that extra boost. Those are the people that we can really help. Because like I said, you know, this is a 12-month program. You know, we not only have this concierge service where we have people really answering any question you may have, but we have people from our marketing team helping you with what your pictures should look like and helping you with how you should list your items. So wording, because wording is so important online, which certain words will get you more hits than other things. And then, you know, the training. We have people who are coming to Baton Rouge to train sellers, show them, you know, again, use this word versus that word. When you're taking pictures, use a white background or use a yellow background because of what you're selling. Maybe you should be listing more items like this versus like that. Kind of stuff that I can't help you with, but experts can. So this program, again, you know, is an investment in Baton Rouge, and I can't stress that enough. But as far as for who should be applying, if you're selling something, you should be applying. You know, if you're selling a tangible item, like, you know, there's a few things, few restrictions, like Damien said, like some perishables that we don't sell on the platform, or we don't sell guns. And, you know, one of the things that actually goes back to D&I, there's certain paraphernalia that we don't sell, like swastikas, Confederate flags, things like that, that we made a conscious and a social decision not to sell. But as far as for products, you'd be surprised of what's sold on eBay. And I think that's the beauty of eBay. You know, a lot of platforms are very like, oh, we don't really sell that because we don't know anything about it. That's not us. If you have an item that you've already been selling, that, you know, you just need that extra leg or that help. Damien mentioned the store earlier. Like he said, people pay for that store. People pay for having that store on eBay. We're giving that to you for free. And not only just giving it to you, we're showing you how to properly market it.
Now, I know there's a question there. I will just say some more just trivia. And this is a ballpark number, but our eBay Motors business, you know, we sell cars on eBay, like 30,000 of them a month. Cars. We sell full cars. You know what else we sell? Big old airplane parts for like $100 million, like engines and stuff. Like, I'm telling you, you can find everything from meat tenderizers to relaxers to T-shirts to plane engines if you should need one of those in the future, okay? I think there was a question.
Yeah, I have a quick question. So far, the dialogue has been about what eBay is going to contribute to these small businesses. You're in a room full of business owners. Business is a two-way street. So what is the expectation of the small businesses or the obligation or commitment to once they do this 12-month program?
There is no post-commitment afterwards. The expectation is that you're courageous and you step into it. Some small businesses say, I'm afraid, I don't really know much about getting out there like that, so that you're open to stepping into it, open to the advice that might, you know, tell you, you know, recommend that you do something totally different, that you're ethical on the platform, that you, and that behooves you too, right? But our platform is only as trustworthy as the businesses who are on our platform. So, you know, you making sure that you actually send stuff to a buyer in a good period of time. That's very important, right? And that really, you take that leap. That's really all we're asking. After that 12-month period, you know, there's not an obligation. Hopefully after that 12-month period, you feel like a part of the eBay family, and there's nothing about that wants to make you actually leave. I think that there could be one of the services or something, it's a 12-month kind of thing where it's actually free, right? And then after that 12 months, is there a small fee associated with it?
There's a small fee associated with it after the 12 months. But, you know, to your point about, you know, how is this a win-win? Because I think that's what you were trying to ask. When we have more businesses on the platform, that's kind of continuing to add to our uniqueness on the platform. Now, to Damien's point about giving your all and being present, you know, we've had some, so this is our fourth city. We've had some cities where we've had to really kind of lean in with the business community. And then we've had other cities where this business community is leaning in with us. So Wolverhampton, United Kingdom, they sold $2 million in GMV in their first year because they were just leaned in. They were ready to go. That's because not only were we contributing our services, but they were right on board with us trying to figure out, okay, well, this is what they're giving us, so let's figure out how we can do it. So the only thing I would say is that, you know, our contributions, I mean, of course, you know, the more people we have on the platform, the more vibrant our platform is, the more unique it is. So that's helping us. But for you all, again, I think the visibility, the opening up of, like I said, the 180 million buyers, and then just the really having the ability. Now, I don't even know if I should be saying this, but I was talking to a business owner earlier, and I said that he was talking about he wants to get his website off the ground and get it going. And I was saying a lot of businesses will use the expertise from our folks on our eBay stores and then build out their own platforms. And so then you have like a dual system where you're not only selling on our website, but you're selling on your own website. And so I feel like that in itself is just a real tool of, again, teaching you what marketing looks like when you're doing an e-commerce business. Something I didn't even know about, again, wording, how wording can really not only just help your traffic to your site, but also your listings on rather our platform or your own. So I think we're...
How are we doing? Good? Okay. Good. Any burning questions that you may have? Can we just take one more? Okay. She gonna yell at me. I saw that look. It's like I told you we was done.
Good morning, everyone. Hi. My name is Candace Perilou, and I'm with The Printing Source. And our services are basically printed marketing materials, so I'm wondering how would that work on the eBay platform?
Printed marketing materials?
Yeah, so everything is basically custom. I'm sorry.
So you customize things. You know, I think that there could be a couple of ways that works, and again, I'll let the expert. Did you introduce yourself? Do the people know who you are?
I'm sorry. I'm Denzel Singletary. I'm on the global government relations team at eBay. So a lot of people ask, what does that even mean? I'm actually not a lobbyist, but I would consider myself maybe like a modern day shepherd. I shepherd our executives and our sellers when we're dealing with government officials locally and nationally.
Yeah, so here's what I would say, and you can answer this as well, but you might be thinking about custom, but you might actually see through your sales what most people want. Or you might see something out there that is not necessarily custom, but you know is relevant to today's day and time, and you might print out, what do you print? Is it signs? Is it posters? Is it t-shirts? Oh, come on. Oh, yeah. Oh, all of that. Absolutely. So, you know, what you might think about doing is diversifying your business, doing a couple of test cases on certain kinds of t-shirts that you think are relevant that are out there and putting those on the platform and seeing how that goes, right? It's another great point about eBay is you can keep your current business but also begin to tinker a little bit and test the waters to diversify your revenue streams to a broader market. Because if you're already in the business of doing that, I mean, just think about all the t-shirts you've seen where you've seen people wearing them across the world, right? Like that could be you as well. I would also think about some of the product that maybe you have that either a customer didn't pick up, that is still universal enough, that may be sitting in your inventory. Don't sleep. Like you can put that stuff on eBay and I guess somebody will buy it. That custom that didn't work for that customer will work in a custom way for somebody who is in India or somebody who is in Istanbul somewhere and wants to buy it. So, okay.
And the only thing I'll just add, so I talked about Brian Robinson in Ohio being successful, the guitar seller. Another seller, Jason, who was in Lansing, Michigan, our second site, same thing, printed t-shirts. And most of his t-shirts are just like sayings, like,
what's like a popular saying, it's above me now. You know, sayings like that, that, you know, his shirts sell. He's doing very well on the platform. Other thing I would add is that equipment that, you know, you may not be using that may be in still usable condition for someone who's just starting out in a business like yours would sell on the platform. Because a lot of our people, like Rather Fits, my good friend who just started a hair salon, she did a lot of her products on eBay. Now, all of them weren't used. She did mostly new products, but the fact that, you know, someone starting out may not be able to afford some of the equipment that you use. And so if you're looking to upgrade or you just aren't using certain equipment anymore, listen on the site. You'd be surprised.
Okay, so we have to wrap for other questions. I think we're going to run out to a room real quick and then maybe be able to come back. And I do this all the time, and I know it's always a problem for my inbox. My email is damien@ebay.com. And I won't get back to you right away. You can email me again if you have a question. But really, I think the best way to go is through the site, what you heard and what's on your tables to apply. Use that as a first step. And then if you have things that maybe you're not getting solved through that process, feel free to email me or email Denzel. I want to say a couple of quick things before I roll, and then we're going to do a selfie, okay? Because this is a beautiful room, and I need to make sure that it's captured. Okay, so a couple of things that I would say to you all, whether it's about retail revival, eBay, the journey of this city, your business, your personal. Number one. I was just on a plane, and every time I hear it, it resonates with me. Secure your oxygen mask first before you help anybody else. What I mean by that is we oftentimes, as a community, in this community, I'm sure, spend a lot of time helping other people. We spend a lot of time taking on other people's stuff and trying to save the world. Whether it's aunties, uncles, your kids, your nieces, your nephews, whoever you might be mentoring at the local community center. We are no good to anybody unless we take care of ourselves. So for some people, that might mean church, it might mean the mosque, it might be meditation, it might mean a therapist. In my line of work, this is tough work. It's not like public service, like the mayor president, but it's tough work. And so I have to take care of myself so that I can take care of others. So that's number one. Number two, I will reiterate, it is long term. So whether you are a business and you're dealing with some challenges today, don't give up. My mother left corporate America 13 years ago and started her business as an entrepreneur out of my old bedroom in our home and is still running that thing and doing her thing. And so it's over time, not necessarily overnight. And then the last thing I'm gonna say is super personal, which is because of them, we can. There's a sister who has a company called Because of Them, We Can. No doubt, today is hard. Today's day and age is hard. No doubt. And no doubt we all wake up some mornings and say, I don't feel like doing this anymore. Whatever it may be, fighting, you know, as a public servant, fighting for access to capital, fighting just to figure out, can I diversify my revenue stream, or just fighting and being who you are authentically in your own community and in your family. And all I would say to you is, imagine if the people before us gave up. We know it wasn't 100 years ago that there were certain buildings we couldn't even walk into. I don't need to remind y'all. Y'all know it out here better than we probably know it from where I'm from. Because of other people who laid down their lives, who fought when there wasn't legislation that supported them, even though legislation is not perfect, when there weren't lawsuits that we could take up, because of other people, we are able to do it. And all I would say is just try to find whatever it is, because there's a bunch of people who are depending on us, some folks who we haven't met yet. All we're doing is continuing to clear the path for folks coming behind us. So I just want you to leave encouraged, knowing that this company, eBay, stands with you, stands to the side of you, stands behind you, that we look forward to your applications, And more than anything, I just look forward to hopefully coming back to this city year after year and hearing about the progress, brother, to your question, and to everybody in this room feeling like, with the leadership of Mayor President, that this community is successful. But I already see it for the simple fact that you're here today, right? So with that, let's take a selfie. Okay, so look, I need y'all to stand, if you're able.
We want to thank everyone. I know everybody's ready to go, but we want to thank everyone for coming out this morning. And we also want to remind you, this may not be applicable. First of all, let's show our appreciation for Damien, Denzel, and Ashley. Ashley, where are you? Let's show our appreciation. And secondly, this may not be applicable for those of you all in the room, but you may know somebody who may be interested. In addition to Retail Revival, we do have the eBay at Home 40 positions. I think they have about 19 left. Customer service positions that you can do from your home. If you know somebody who may be looking for an at-home job, dealing with customer service, they can go to ebayinc.com and customer service positions are there. Thank you.